Welcome to another episode of the Merck Manuals Medical Myths podcast. On this show, we set the record straight on today's most talked about medical topics and questions. I'm your host, Joe McIntyre, and on this episode, we welcome Dr. Bernard J. Hennessy, DDS, which is Doctor of Dental Surgery, at Texas A&M University School of Dentistry. We're going to be discussing a topic that can be quite embarrassing for a number of people, halitosis, or more commonly known as bad breath. Dr. Hennessy, thanks for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
So let's start off with a little bit of the basics here. What exactly is halitosis and what causes it?
Halitosis is obviously probably well known to a lot of people. And it, as you said in your intro, it's another way to describe bad breath. And there's multiple causes. It could be as simple as foods that we eat, but most likely the majority of them are probably related to bacteria in our mouth. And dealing with foods that we eat, they can break things down and cause bad breath.
How common is halitosis?
If you read, it'll get into the literature to read about it. There's a number of different numbers kind of reported, but it's probably up to 25% of the population may have persistent bad breath. Sometimes some studies report numbers a little bit lower, 15 to 25%, probably in the range.
Now, when it comes to, I guess, bad breath, is it something that society has deemed this to be bad breath, or is it always, is there something in our psyche, I guess, that tells us that this person's breath is a foul smell or foul odor? How does that kind of come to be?
I think probably depending on how closely we interact with people, the spaces we're in, but I think we've all kind of are sensitive to it. And there's certain odors that I think we would pick up probably. And you kind of know someone just had a meal or something maybe more intense in a way.
Got it. Now let's dive into some of the myths and misconceptions a little bit. Do mouthwashes or breath mints get rid of bad breath?
Yeah, so mouthwashes and breath mints, they can help mask bad breath. But if someone's, if a mouth rinse would say like, hey, use this product and eliminate your bad breath, that's not true. It can temporarily mask it, but not necessarily eliminate it.
Okay. As we've talked about, so many of us are self-conscious about having bad breath, whether it's on a date, you're out with someone, you're out with friends, you're out with family. Can you tell if you have bad breath if you breathe into your cupped hands?
Yeah, I bet you probably most people have tried that, because you're not sure. But the truth is you probably get used to your own breath. And so that probably wouldn't really be an effective way. You might be thinking you're good, and maybe a friend would tell you you're not. So a good friend, maybe.
That's a tough scene.
Yes.
You mentioned mouthwashes don't get rid of bad breath, mostly cover it. What about brushing your teeth? Is that the same kind of thing?
Yeah, well, certainly brushing your teeth because most of the causes of bad breath are kind of originate in the mouth. Effective brushing of teeth has certainly got to help, but it's not just the teeth. We have the tongue. There's a lot of surface area on the tongue. Food particles, bacteria can get stuck on there. So I think people maybe don't always brush their tongue effectively. And so I think that's another part of the brushing and tongue and teeth. And then the brushing doesn't always deal with the food and bacteria that can get in between teeth. And so we have to use something to eliminate that, floss, there's mechanical devices, things like that, that probably would contribute to reducing bad breath.
You mentioned effectively brushing your tongue. I know this is a audio only medium, so try to be as descriptive as you can. What is the best way to brush your tongue to get rid of some of those bacteria and avoid bad breath?
You could buy devices, tongue scrapers, and depending on, some of us have like more of the extensions that we call them filiform papillae, things that stick up on your tongue. Some of us have the more robust, I guess, and so they might benefit from a scraper. Most of us, you could just use your toothbrush and just kind of brush probably from back to front, not too far back. You'll gag yourself, and I think that's an effective way to clean your tongue for most of us.
If you are on a date or just want to avoid getting bad breath in general, what sorts of foods or drinks should you avoid?
Yeah, I mean, so And that's interesting, you know, depending on, you know, you're on a date, you might want to have a glass of wine or something. So sometimes alcohol is one of the things that could contribute to that. Certain foods, you know, things with garlic, some spicy things, that, you know, that could, onions, you know, that foods like that. I don't think it would mean you wouldn't have to not order them on the menu, but I think you'd have to just be aware that that could change your breath. And certainly if anyone were a smoker as well, that combination of smoking and alcohol probably would contribute to some bad breath as well.
Are there any particular diets that would cause bad breath more so than others?
You know, I think that if you're thinking about diets and bad breath, it's probably like the keto diet is one of the things that there's, I guess, the way that diet is structured, that people, it's kind of high in fat. And if the body is forced to use fats for energy, it can break down fats into ketones, which can have kind of like an acetone nail polish type smell. So I think some people on a keto diet might experience that. And but beyond that, I'm not aware of too many other diets that might affect that bad breath.
Now, you're a dentist. I'm sure you hear people talking about everything dealing with the mouth all the time. So are there any other myths about halitosis that you've heard or that have come across to you in your career that you may want to debunk?
Yeah, I mean, you know, I've heard things like, you know, hey, bad breath maybe originates from the stomach, not from the mouth, and that's not true. There's certainly a few things, a very small percentage of maybe medical conditions that could contribute to bad breath. So that's one of them. Another thing was, you know, we kind of already talked about, like, mouth rinses curing bad breath. You know, they can help mask, but they don't cure. And then even things like, chewing on certain, like, green leafy vegetable or leaves or things that maybe be may have a nice fresh scent, but they also might have high in chlorophyll or something. And the thought was, oh, chlorophyll's got to kind of purify your breath. There's nothing to that. You know, another myth probably.
Yeah, another natural remedy I think we've seen or heard of before is using maybe peppermint oil as a way to mask it too. Does that help or prevent it at all?
Well, oils like that, I mean, there's certainly in peppermint candies and things, you know, you could certainly mask things. And I think the way I understand some of those oils are, they're not necessarily well regulated to be ingested. So I probably wouldn't recommend anyone doing that. I think a peppermint, you know, and obviously if you could find a sugar-free peppermint as a dentist speaking, that would probably be a better way to go.
Sure. So when you said you can't breathe in your cupped hands to kind of tell if you have bad breath, obviously I panicked, because that means how would I even know if I have bad breath or not? So is there any way to tell if you have bad breath or not without someone directly saying, hey, buddy, you have bad breath?
You know, unless you did some kind of like a gas chromatography or something, a test, I think a lot of times it's going to be a friend or partner, someone might say, hey, you know, maybe you need to chew some gum or something. I mean, that's really, it's hard to do it ourselves,
Just get better friends. That seems like the best
really.
solution.
I think that's, yeah, we could all use better friends, more friends, probably, yeah.
Can certain medications cause halitosis as a side effect?
There's probably a few maybe uncommon meds. It's there's case reports, I think, in the literature of some uncommon things, but there's a lot of common medications like blood pressure meds and have side effects where they literally dry the mouth, and that's not just that type of medication. So that's pretty common. And then as our mouth gets dry, I think we tend to have a tendency for more bad breath. You don't have the saliva that naturally kind of lubricates and flushes things away.
Got it. I think you kind of mentioned this already, but just to confirm, halitosis pretty much only originates in the mouth. It doesn't really come from other parts of the body, and except for some more, rare circumstances, correct?
Yeah, you know, you could probably say there might be about 10% of causes could be something other than the mouth. And so the way we would kind of, you know, if someone had issues with bad breath, I think probably starting with the dentist and working on hygiene and things like that is probably the best way to proceed. If that didn't work and there was some persistent thing, then it certainly would be worth probably a referral to a medical colleague, ENT specialist, maybe. There's things that could cause bad breath. For instance, even related to the keto diet, diabetes, uncontrolled diabetes could cause the same type of ketoacidosis that you could get that acetone smell. There's certain things maybe with the liver that could cause kind of a musty smell. These things get into the blood, and these gases get expelled through the lungs. So we could pick up on things. Someone had an abscess in their tonsil, perhaps, or something in the lung. But that's a very small percentage of causes of bad breath.
Okay. Can halitosis be a sign of a more serious underlying health issue, or is it kind of, you know, just there? It's just a symptom of, you know, either poor hygiene in the mouth or something else.
Yeah, I mean, I kind of just based kind of following on our previous question there. Yeah, it could be in a small percentage of things.
Yeah,
it could be. And so certainly I think persistent halitosis that people have run through everything that a dentist would recommend and everything, it certainly probably would warrant, you know, maybe a further look.
Yeah. Let's see. You're going to the dentist, as you probably should, every 6 months or so. Is there anything you should do to prepare for going to the dentist? One, to make sure that you're, you know, in having a good experience, whether it's flossing or brushing before, but even, you know, the hour before, avoid having lunch, doing this. Is there anything you should do as you're going to the dentist? You know, some tips as you're going to your office.
I guess if you're going to the dentist with a specific complaint of halitosis, you know, I certainly would probably be good to avoid any kind of food that could maybe contribute to that and maybe mask what you're really dealing with. But I think probably the other part of going to the dentist is just kind of having your teeth as clean as possible. It makes it easier for the dentist to kind of see what's going on in there. As a youngster, I used to think that if I hadn't brushed my teeth for a long time, I could spend about 10 minutes before I went to the dentist. But generally, I'd make your teeth a little bit cleaner, but it's not going to cure other things. So,
Got it. Are there any stories? I mean, you've been a dentist for a while now. Any stories that kind of come to mind about someone being, you know, confused about halitosis and you help them with a solution? Anything that kind of would help our listeners understand that this is a common issue and nothing to really be embarrassed about, but something that can be treated?
Well, I don't think I have a super great story, but it certainly is a number of patients where, you know, they've been dealing with halitosis for a while and maybe trying to use mouth rinses and things and with maybe, you know, minimal success. But when you get down and you're able to show them, hey, you know, maybe you haven't been brushing your tongue, or maybe there, you know, you know, if we have prominent tonsils, they have crypts where food and things can be caught in there, and that can contribute to kind of odor. So I think there's kind of common, easy things that can be done for a lot of patients that would kind of help them deal with this and feel better about it.
Dr. Hennessy, as we kind of close out the conversation here, where should our listeners go to learn more about the symptoms, diagnosis, prevention, or anything else regarding halitosis?
Well, you know, there's certainly a lot of resources for people to find things. I think certainly go into the Merck manuals. Merckmanual.com is a great place to start. There, you know, in the consumer edition, there's a lot of information related to this. I think the American Dental Association, they have a consumer site where you can learn about brushing and flossing and devices that might help keep things clean. I think those are probably two real good places to start.
Well, Dr. Hennessy, thank you so much for joining us on this podcast. Certainly a great conversation, busting some of the myths about halitosis. As we close out, I'll let you leave our listeners with the final word.
Medical knowledge is power. Pass it on.
Thank you.